The human brain is arguably one of the most complex places in the universe. This intricate, delicately balanced network of more than 80 billion neurons is constantly communicating, both electrically and chemically, to help you do everything you do, automatically and consciously. But when this finely balanced system goes wrong, it can be devastating, and we need better solutions. And the future of treating some brain-based diseases may just lie in neural implants. Devices that go into your brain.
Seizures themselves, I should say, are basically abnormal electrical activity in the brain. Because, our brains harness electricity all the time. That's what we do to kind of talk and think. But seizures are where that kind of goes awry.
This is John Clean. He's a neurologist at UCSF who specializes in epilepsy care. He and other neuroscientists and neurosurgeons at UCSF have worked with the scientists and engineers at LLNL to come up with novel solutions to treat disorders like epilepsy and others.
So epilepsy is a condition where someone has spontaneous seizures that recur, like they happen over and over and you can't really prevent them or stop them except with certain treatments.
These treatments primarily consist of anticonvulsant medications that are taken orally. And for some people, they work really well. But for many, they can have really life-altering side effects, or they can eventually stop working. While for others, they don't work at all to begin with. So the world is on the hunt for better solutions to brain-based illnesses like epilepsy.
We built electrode arrays, we built the implantable packages and everything that went with that. And the goal for that was to basically eventually demonstrate that you could actually build a full implant that rather than taking drugs to kind of correct for like severe PTSD, severe anxiety, things like that, which don't aren't as effective as we would like them all to be. Could we have a neural implant that could do that? So neuromodulation was the answer to that.
Neuromodulation is an exciting area of neuroscience that involves devices that have two main jobs, sensing and stimuli.
Basically, you listen for brain activity. And then when you hear a seizure, detect a seizure, then you loop back and respond to it, you stimulate it. And
so for epilepsy or for mood disorders, we'll use epilepsy as an example. Right now it's detecting, okay, there's a seizure about to start. I better send a stimulation over here to prevent that seizure.
As surprising as it may sound, devices like this have existed and been used safely inside humans for decades in the case of something like heart disorders. There is actually already an FDA-approved device that exists in the brains of patients walking around today that does this kind of electrical control for epilepsy. And it does work quite well, reducing seizure occurrence by about 75% for folks with really severe epilepsy. But it can take years to get to this point, because the impulses the device sends out have to be tailored so specifically to each individual, and it takes a really long time for the device to learn how to do that properly.
We still have a long way to go. Better bandwidth for devices, better storage capacities, the ability to record brainwaves continuously for a long term, and from more and more electrodes, so there's more versatility. Those are kind of like the forefronts of what are happening right now. Then you can really get the detail of those brainwaves, and you can hopefully tailor it much better for that person's epilepsy.
Which is exactly what scientists at Lawrence Livermore have been working on.
Commercial deep brain stimulators, those range from 4 to 8 channels. We've built some deep brain stimulation type devices. They're the exact same dimensions, but we basically have added quite a few more channels, which we believe is going to be very important for neural engineering in the future, for fine control, for stimulation in only specific spots.
With LLNL, we've been using this opportunity to try these what we call microgrids, or grids with many, many more electrodes, very high density and spaced like perfectly. These are great opportunities really to record information at scales like never before seen.
John and his colleagues at UCSF have already used devices like this to study memory formation. Other work has looked at areas in the brain associated with learning, and the hope is that as we progress, these devices could give us so much more insight into how the brain works.
And hopefully those sorts of new ways to stimulate and higher density electrodes are going to be ways that we can augment or improve like the status quo. Because it's really, like I said, not acceptable right now. So many people are still having a lot of seizures, and we need to take these opportunities, leverage these special grids to find out if there's new ways that we can help.
And not only is LLNL improving the amount and sensitivity of data we can gather from these devices, we're changing the kind of data that can be gathered too.
My particular interest is in making chemical sensors onto those probes as well. We put down these layers that can be polymers or even enzymes, for example, that enhance the electrode and allow them to specifically pick up one chemical out of, you know, the dozens that are going on in your brain so that we can kind of provide a more complete picture to neuroscientists.
This kind of data could give us radically more detailed and nuanced information about what's going on in someone's brain when they're experiencing a mental health issue or a neurodegenerative disease like Parkinson's, which could make our treatment of these illnesses so much more informed and effective. This kind of technology is also paving the way for next generation neural prostheses, or implantable devices that could help those with brain injuries or disabilities see, speak, or hear better than they can now. These kinds of improvements to neural implants involve radical innovation around the chemical and electrical engineering of the devices, and even the materials they're made of.
Thinking about how soft your brain tissue is, it's basically very similar to Jell-O almost. So there are a lot of commercial technologies out there that have stiffer materials such as silicon. And so you can imagine something that's as stiff as a, you know, sharp needle going into this Jell-O, and your brain's naturally moving just from, you know, your heartbeat and everything. And so if you have a stiff material in there while your brain's moving around, that's going to cause a lot of damage around your implant site. Whereas on the other hand, with our probes, because they're so flexible, they kind of move with the brain.
Now, we have to emphasize that this work is still very experimental, and studies in humans have so far only been able to take place during short surgeries. For example, some patients struggling with something like severe epilepsy may need to have some of their brain tissue removed as part of their regular treatment. And during these surgeries, a doctor can place an implant on a surface of an area of their brain to test the device's capabilities over the duration of the surgery. Rezi, Allison, and the rest of the LNL team are continuing to increase the amount and kind of data these devices can collect, improving their flexibility, decreasing their size. And each of these steps gets us a little bit closer to having a highly effective therapeutic device that can stay inside the patient for long periods of time while they're just living their lives.
There's now a possibility that I see, at least. There's a lot of work to get there. And we have, you know, wonderful team members like Allison and a whole bunch of other people to bring us to that point where we could actually put a full system together and solve a problem that people have now.
There's just so many different potential applications that our probes could be used for, you know, seeing if our devices could help with something like ALS, for example, or even looking at the spinal cord too. A lot of the work that we talked about so far has been mainly in the brain, but we could potentially use it in so many more other places in the body.
Now, all of this is really just the tip of the iceberg when it comes to neural implant work at LLNL. So if you have questions about this kind of project, please do leave it for us in the comments below. We'd love to hear from you. And check out this video here for more brain-based work at LLNL. Subscribe to this channel for more videos that take you inside the lab's amazing science and technology. And as always, thank you so much for watching. I'll see you in the next one.